In this screencast, we'll discuss the concept of solubility and read solubility diagrams to determine the parameters necessary to solve material balances that involve solids and liquids. So what is solubility? We could define it as the maximum amount of a solute that can be dissolved in a solvent at equilibrium. And the reason I say solute and solvent is it doesn't necessarily mean a solid in a liquid. It could also be a gas in a liquid. So at this point, we consider the solution to be saturated when no more solute can be dissolved. Now you can imagine temperature plays a large role in the solubility of a species in a particular solvent. Now let's take a look at a solubility diagram of some salts in water as a function of temperature. So here's a solubility diagram showing the solubility in grams of salt in 100 grams of water on the y-axis and temperature in degrees Celsius on the x-axis. It's important to notice that the effect of temperature on solubility is different for each species. Some solutes like potassium chloride have a fairly constant increase in solubility with temperature, while something like potassium nitrate, KNO3, has a very drastic increase in solubility with increasing temperature for this given range. Now notice that our Ce2SO43 down here at the bottom actually decreases in solubility with increasing temperature for a range and then stays pretty constant. So these effects can be very drastically different depending on the species. So notice how the y-axis is labeled. It's important to note when taking solubility data. If we look at sodium chloride at 90 degrees Celsius, let's take a look at sodium chloride at 90 degrees Celsius. We trace up the 90 degree line up to our sodium chloride. We see it intersects at 40 grams of NaCl per 100 grams of water. Note that this is not the same as saying that our NaCl is 40 weight percent of our solution. Now to change it into a weight percent, we could write 40 grams of our solute in our total amount of solute and solvent, so that's 40 grams of NaCl plus 100 grams of water. This gives us a weight percent of 28.6% NaCl in our solution. So now let's use this type of diagram to help solve a material balance on a crystallizer unit. So let's say we have a crystallizer unit that's used to remove potassium dichromate from solution. In a saturated solution, so let's say we have a crystallizer that's used to remove potassium dichromate from a solution. A saturated solution of the potassium dichromate enters at 60 degrees Celsius. So 60 degrees Celsius, we have a saturated solution of potassium dichromate in water. It enters the crystallizer where the temperature is maintained at 20 degrees Celsius. So we can say that the exiting temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. Now this drop in temperature induces crystals that become entrained in the solution. So we're going to have a saturated solution of our potassium dichromate. So we'll have some water making up that solution, and then we'll also have a solid stream that's entrained in that solution, so some amount of crystals. Now the goal is to produce 200 kilograms of crystal solids. So we fill that information in, that are filtered out of a solution that is twice the flow rate of the solids. So that means we have 400 kilograms. So that means we have 400 kilograms of our saturated solution. So how much water needs to be evaporated from the crystallizer to make this happen? So we have a stream of water, some unknown flow rate, we'll say MH2O. So where do we start with a problem like this? First thing, as I've drawn this, as I've read it through the problem, is to label any other unknowns that we don't have. So one unknown is the incoming flow rate of our feed, so I'll say MF. We also don't know the weight percent or composition of that feed stream. So we'll call this XA and 1 minus XA. I've labeled the unknown mass flow rate of water that's being evaporated from the crystallizer, and that's what we're looking for. And we have the mass flow rates of the saturated solution and crystals of our potassium dichromate. However, we don't know the concentration of that saturated solution. So I'll call that YA, the mass fraction of the potassium dichromate in the exiting stream, and 1 minus YA for the mass fraction of water. So how do we determine what those compositions are? As you can see, we can't really do any material balances without figuring out some more information. And that's the nice thing about solubility. So we could typically look these values up given a temperature and a pressure. Now, if we assume that this is being operated at atmospheric pressure, then we just have to look at the solubility as a function of temperature. So let's go back to that solubility plot that we had before. So we're looking at potassium dichromate, which is the purple line on the plot. I'm highlighting green. We need to read off the solubility at both 20 degrees Celsius and 60 degrees Celsius. So at 60 degrees Celsius, we're looking right about there, which gives us, off of my graph, 38 grams of potassium dichromate per 100 grams of water. And I tend to write it this way so I know it's not 38 weight percent. 20 degrees Celsius, we're looking around there on the plot, and I read this as about 12 grams of potassium dichromate per 100 grams of water. So, first thing to do is convert these to mass fractions. So if you recall, it's just the amount of solute over the total mass. So at 60 degrees, this is 38 grams over 138 grams, which is equal to 0.275 or 27.5 weight percent. And at 20 degrees, we have 12 grams over 112 grams, which is equivalent to 0.107 or 10.7 weight percent. So now we could use these mass fractions in our material balance in schematic to fill in for the compositions of the incoming stream and outgoing saturated streams. So I've redrawn our schematic with the information that we know for our compositions of the inlet and outlet of the crystallizer. And as you see, we have two unknowns, our flow rate into the crystallizer and our mass flow rate of the water being evaporated out. We know that we could write two material balances, either an overall balance, a potassium dichromate balance, or a water balance. So let's start with an overall balance. We know that the mass of the feed has to be equal to the mass of the water that's being evaporated out, plus 600 kilograms that are leaving. And that's 200 kilograms of our crystals and 400 kilograms of our solution. Now, if I was to do a water balance, we have 0.725, our weight fraction, times our flow rate of water times our flow rate in has to be equal to the mass flow rate of the water leaving plus, now we don't take any water from our crystals, but from our solution, it's 0.903 times 400. So as you see, we have two unknowns and two equations we could solve for the mass flow rates, and I get the mass flow rate of water is equal to 268 kilograms of water being evaporated, and this is for a feed of 868 kilograms of potassium dichromate and water. And this is for a feed of 868 kilograms of our saturated potassium dichromate solution that's at 60 degrees Celsius. And remember, in this problem statement, we were given conditions such that we produced 200 kilograms of crystal and 400 kilograms of solution at a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius. So do note the difference between the crystals and the solution. This is sometimes called a slurry of solids in solution. The slurry is a saturated solution of the potassium dichromate that also has precipitated crystals that's entrained in the solution. So the water balance only looks at the solution since the crystals are just precipitated solids that flow along with our solution. So solubility is an important parameter that we may be able to take advantage of when looking at separation techniques between solids and liquids or gases and liquids. Now the main takeaway message is to be careful when using these diagrams, as it's typical to report the solubility as an amount of solute per amount of solvent, and it's not the same as a weight percent. So hopefully that helps.